There's almost no doubt the Earth is warming due to human-induced climate change. The mining industry must know global warming will mean the end of coal. All they can do is delay the inevitable. Coal wreaks havoc on communities, health and the environment, and will quickly be a stranded asset. My father, John Davis, was a science filmmaker and producer of the website Energy Without Carbon. John knew renewables could answer our energy needs, and he asked, so why are we mining coal and coal seam gas? How is it worth it for Australia or for anyone? He didn't get to finish his last project he was deeply committed to. John died in a helicopter crash in November 2015 whilst filming for this documentary. So with the help of family and friends, we've done it for him.
From a farmer's perspective, our biggest issue is governments always take miners' side. We believe we own the land, but we actually don't own the land when someone else from a mining company wants to take it over.
Because 86% of our coal companies are foreign owned, they do not pay for that resource. All they do is give our governments a tip.
I think when governments and, and mining companies work so closely together and people are seeing those links play out in the public eye, then people have no choice but to take action.
What I believe we're doing is making the biggest strategic blunder ever in the history of Australia by continuing to assume that the 20th century high carbon world, where we benefited by supplying coal and gas and oil and so on to the Japanese and Chinese and in future the Indian economies, we're assuming that will continue. And frankly, it can't. So we will have wasted enormous amounts of money on the wrong sort of projects. We will not have built the low carbon economy we're going to need for the future. That potentially is an enormous benefit to Australia because we have better renewable resources than probably anybody else in the world if we choose to use them, which we're not.
Paolo Cassoni and neighbours got together and bought 8,000 hectares to preserve remnant woodland. They called it Bimble Box Nature Reserve. It was listed with the government, who they assumed would protect it. However, the land contained coal.
Bimble Box is located in the desert uplands bioregion, which is where the wetter eastern country meets the drier inland desert of the west, and it's a biodiversity hotspot. And underneath this beautiful soil are these lovely sandstone aquifers that seep the rain, that collect the rain, and this region recharges the Great Artesian Basin. The rainwater collects here and falls down slowly, leaches all the way across Queensland and flows out into northern New South Wales, and it takes thousands of years to do that. The proposed mine for this area is one of 9 mega mines for the Galilee Basin. Any one of those mines is proposing a scale of extraction that is unprecedented. I think people aren't aware of the scale of the extraction that's being proposed. Many scientists believe that the Galilee Basin is one reserve that should be left untouched, left in the ground, because if it's extracted, we could seriously reach that point of dangerous climate change. The most confronting thing for me about what's happening in to Bimble Box, the property, was that this property was acquired by private individuals. It attracted government support federally and had a state government agreement to protect it. But the coal underneath this ground surpasses all of the efforts that have been made to preserve it. And that private concern has right of way over what should be, I think, a democratic process to decide the future of this place.
Why are artists here?
Well, we're just hoping to capture in visual art
you know, the character of this place and express, you know, to the wider public, hopefully, what we have to lose here.
I think the art project is an important and maybe gentle way of communicating these really serious issues to a broad community, which is perhaps less confrontational and hopefully less polarising of the community. We're hoping that the communities that see the show will be able to contemplate the issues and have conversations in ways that don't threaten them but just opens up the subject for further debate.
We are going to have to move far faster than anybody in either side of politics in this country has ever been prepared to talk about. It's not a question of a 5% emission reduction by 2020. You have to have 10 times that much, 50%. You have to have almost completely decarbonize the economy by 2050. Now, we are going to be faced with those sort of decisions before very long. We should already have made them, but we haven't. But as they say, nature bats last, so it doesn't matter what view is taken in politics, we will have to face up to this sooner or later. What we're doing in the meantime is we are committing ourselves to further expand high carbon projects like the Galilee Basin coal expansion in Queensland, all of which are going to be investments that before long, and I would argue that within a decade, will become stranded. That means that we will have wasted a vast amount of money into projects that cannot continue if you are going to steer clear of really potentially catastrophic outcomes.
State governments provide enormous assistance to the mining industry, and the real banana republic here is Queensland. Over the last 6 years, Queensland have spent about $9.5 billion, mainly on railway lines and some port infrastructure for their coal industry. They then grant cheap access to a lot of that infrastructure, and that discount runs at about $500 million a year.
The coal industry is one of the worst examples of cross-subsidisation, where it is the large corporations that make a fortune out of coal, and it is the rest of the community that pays the price. If companies think it's worth $100, then that is the value of that coal to them. But for every tonne of coal, there's about 3 tonnes of carbon dioxide emitted. Each of those tonnes does about $200 of damage. That means there's about $600 of climate damage being done for a tonne of coal that's probably only worth $100 to the market.
Carbon emissions from burning coal are one of the leading causes of global warming.
This empty coal train is heading for the mines at Collinsville. It has come from Abbott Point inside the Great Barrier Reef. Collinsville is a proud old mining town built on underground coal mining. But lately things have changed. Huge open cut mines stands in their way.
We were never anti-mining, and now we just are overwhelmed with the evidence that shows us that this is not the way we need to go. We just wanted to save our Coral Creek.
The line of trees marks Coral Creek, and underneath it lies a fortune in coal, which the miners want. They plan to dig a new creek and divert the water into it. We went to meet two people living downstream who are fighting this proposal.
I'm a local wildlife carer, and I love this piece of country in this part of Australia. When the mine was being proposed here, the issue was raised about Coral Creek, which was a particularly lovely little creek that we love to explore.
Well, this here is the bed of Coral Creek, and that's coal. The amount of coal under this creek is actually an insignificant amount of coal, but, you know, the consequences of mining a creek are really, you know, very significant and a really high risk.
So why bother ruin this creek just for a little bit of coal?
Because the coal was close to the surface, it was easy to get at, it was a good quantity of coal, it was easy money. And so we put in submissions went through the process, tried to save the creek from this exploitation. 3 years down the track now, they have won permission to go ahead and dig it up. And the travesty is, in our process of doing our research, we found that the government is allowing creeks all over Queensland to be dug up and diverted, which is going to cause problems in the future, because they only have to make it look like a creek for 10 years so that any future problems with erosion or runoff becomes the problem of the general public. The mining companies have no responsibility. In this dry country of Australia, water is precious and we're not doing enough to look after it.
As you can see, this is all, it's all dry, but under the sand here is the moisture. There it is there.
Even in the most, you know, severe droughts, this hole has never dried up. And because of the mining under the creek, several kilometres upstream, there's a significant risk that the water will be lost and it won't get to here in the dry season and in droughts. And we rely on this water where we draw our water for our farm.
People don't want to take on the mining company because they're so powerful. Gary, with his life experiences, feels that he needs to make a stand because he feels that this is the right thing to do. And I admire the fact that he has stood up to be counted and hasn't backed off in the face of such a opposition. It's cost him all his family savings. He would have been quite comfortable on, and it's also jeopardised the future for the farm. And they've tried to intimidate with huge costings against him, and he's managed to stand up and say, no, I'm not going to be silenced and I'm not going to back down.
Yeah, well, I think mining is overruling everything. Everybody thinks that's where all the money's coming from, but it might be at this time, but it's like short-term gain for long-term pain. It's not going to affect us, but more or less more our children, our grandchildren. What's going to be left for them? That's what my main concern is.
The whole system just seems to be opening up mines to anywhere and everywhere sort of thing. Some of the mines, as soon as they start running into a cost, get bigger as they go deeper. They close them down and just start another mine. That seems to be what's happening at times.
The government, I feel, is concentrating too much on the mine and forgetting about a lot of the other industries like our cattle industry, but general farm industry, ordinary manufacturing from, like, fruit and vegetables. That's been forgotten, I think.
Have you noticed any disruption to your way of life?
Employment on the farm properties. It's harder to get people to work because we can't afford the wages that the mines pay.
Because of the mine situation, the prices of rent has gone up that much. It's more than tripled in places, or even more than that. And that, of course, has all got to come from somewhere, and they can't live on the wages that they normally receive.
We haven't been told a thing about the dam. And a few years ago, I did ring them when it was in the wind before and asked them what was happening, and they asked me why was I concerned. I said, well, it was really affecting us because it was going to take, you know, a lot of our property up.
Mick and Judy are left pondering the destruction of their home, farm, future and local wildlife.
This is where the proposed Urana Dam will finish. And over the second ridge is the other part where it'll go up.
All the country below is probably our best grazing country, and also access to the rest of our property. We use the river and river country. We have our set of cattle yards down there and lanes and whatever else. The actual area is a very unique area as far as it is covered under the Australian wetlands. It's a very unique area in Queensland that takes in Broken River, Urana Creek, Massey Creek, and quite a few other little creeks that run into them. The problem with this dam is it'll take the best part of our farm and basically leave us the desert, the tops of the hills, which are beautiful in the rainy season, but not all year round. As far as I know, the river system's supposed to only have one dam on each river. Well, this one's going to have two, and it's going to be within 10 or 15 kilometres of each other with the water side of it. So just too much strain on the whole system, the whole environmental side impact of it, and you're just tying up so much water, and that's...
A lot of water down there. They're going to pump it up to...
As far as the water goes, I couldn't think that we'll get any benefit at all from it. All the pumps will be going the other way, Bowen, Collinsville, whatever else, to the Abbott Point jetty, what do you call it, bloody
port
there, and we won't have any come back this way at all, as far as I know.
I'm here in support of Jonathan Moylan, who issued a false press release just to attract attention to the issue of the ANZ Bank funding Whitehaven Coal, which is in the process of building an absolutely huge, disastrous open-pit coal mine in the middle of the Laird State Forest, which will cause so much destruction. They're the ones who should be here in court, not Jonathan Boylan today.
I mean, it just doesn't make any sense to keep burning fossil fuels. I mean, once it kind of clicks in your own mind, like what's happening, then there's kind of no going back. Like, you can't accept it the way things are. And that's really basically what's for me. But I'm just really worried about the future for my kids.
Increasingly, what we're seeing across Australia is legislators under the influence of big business not represent their constituency. They're going into parliaments and writing laws that the big end of town, the big miners, want. But what's actually happening on the ground is the community, farmers, environmentalists, people in the suburbs of the major metropolitan centres are saying, this is not in our public interest. It's not in our collective interest. And so what they're doing is they're writing letters. They're furiously lobbying their members of parliament, but they're being ignored. So they've got no choice, and they are now undertaking a mass campaign of civil disobedience.
Maules Creek was Nathan Tinkler's biggest interest. It was also the first coal mine in New South Wales where the community were barred from challenging the legality of the approval in court. There were serious questions raised by the planning department about offsets, about the final void, and all of those concerns disappeared through the planning process. That's really raised a lot of questions for people in the community about whether the mine should have been approved in the first place and whether the mine's approval was a product of corruption.
You go to a protest, whether it's out of the Laird Forest or at Bentley or somewhere in the centre of the city, and these protests aren't just long-haired hippies from the 60s. There are lawyers, there are nurses, there are knitting grandparents, there are farmers, there are young students and activists. It's a cross-section of the community that's coming out and demanding a different response from their government. And that's something that this government and the former government have had an awful lot of difficulty coming to terms with. These aren't your usual suspects in their eyes. These are people from across the community demanding more.
That's good.
Hello, mate.
Hi, Ivan.
Hi,
well done.
Okay.
How's it
going?
Nearly 50 people showed up here at 2 a.m. and we trekked out across the paddocks towards the clearing site. This crew walked about 12 kilometres together to get there. It was incredible. As a big group, we walked down towards where their work camp was and the kind of the latest clearing sites they've been working on. Security started tailing us at the front and back whilst we were doing that. We decided to move down towards a work camp we could see with some of the machines down there. We obviously made the right choice because as soon as we started walking down that road, all the security guards lined up in front of us and resisted us getting forward. But again, the crew stayed very tight as a whole. we walked on peacefully, calmly, and we made progress down the road and kind of planted ourselves outside their machine camp.
Okay, George, you want to tell me what we're doing here?
Yes, we're occupying the Laird State Forest, which is threatened this morning with unlawful bulldozing to make way for the Moores Creek coal mine. We're trying to keep the forest standing until an urgent injunction can be heard in the New South Wales Land and Environment Court. This road is the place where the bulldozers would be coming this morning to go into the forest to do more clearing, and we're peacefully occupying it, and we're determined to keep the forest up.
In the ground,
we owe it to all nations and to future generations to leave the fossil fuels in the ground.
When people see these bloody-minded, anti-community, anti-environment, and economically reckless decisions being made by the government, many of them, I think, are rightly questioning how could a notionally democratic system be producing these perverse outcomes and consistently privilege a corporate's short-term profit interest over the long-term environmental, social and economic interests of the community.
The Warkworth project in the Hunter Valley is an amazing case where no fewer than seven economists have examined this in front of two courts. And it's been shown time and time again that the costs of this development are far greater than the benefits to New South Wales. This has been argued about for years, over hundreds of pages. And yet this week we've got another report coming out from a supposedly respected economist in Australia still trying to claim that the benefits of this project are worth it for New South Wales.
It's enough. You are devastating our countryside. The minerals people, the BHPs and Rio Tinto say, but hang on a second, we've got a 40-year future ahead of us because we can sell coal to the third world countries. So they're going to devastate our countryside, yeah, and they're going to take that coal, send it over there so they can pollute their air and wreck their countryside. Yeah. We've fought one of the biggest mining companies in the world, we've won. We've fought the state government and we've won. Then the government decided this wasn't good enough. They weren't getting their way, so they brought in what they call the SEP Amendment. And that SEP Amendment said the coal resource is the most significant matter. And would you believe that this company, Rio Tinto, has now resubmitted exactly the same scheme, yeah, as they had rejected by two courts, and they're trying again.
They changed the law. They applied it retrospectively to the Bulgo matter. And then to really nail it home, they then, through the planning minister, issued a fresh delegation for the Bulgo matter. They invited Rio Tinto to put a fresh application in, and the planning minister issued a delegation that said the approval of Bulga will be heard by the Planning Assessment Commission and only the Planning Assessment Commission. It'll be heard in accordance with their new pro-mining policy, and they will prevent any future appeal to the Land and Environment Court.
The current practice of the New South Wales government is for all major mining projects get sent to what's called the Planning Assessment Commission to hold a public hearing as part of a review. The community has to register that it would like to talk to the PAC. You have two members, possibly three members of the Planning Assessment Commission, that's the PAC, and the community gets 5 minutes to present their case and their objection as to why the impacts they say are going to be significant.
This will risk even more of our best farming land and artesian water as the ugliness of mining moves over the Great Dividing Range onto the northwest slopes and plains.
Once a public hearing has been held, then members of the community have no right to access a court to review and present their expert evidence to a court or cross-examine the proponents, experts on the impacts.
Yeah. Okay.
The minerals industry would have you believe it is the most predominant whatever industry in the Hunter Valley. It is not. Agriculture, wine and tourism, and the equine industry are far bigger than the mining industry. But it is the Minerals Resource Company who has the sway with government.
So we have laws in New South Wales that protect the community from political donations that might corrupt our systems, but the Independent Commission Against Corruption has shown that there have been illegal political donations coming from companies with interests in the mining industry to political parties to grease the wheels, if you like, for their projects. It's hard to see how these donations are happening because they're happening illegally. But the community's right to be concerned that behind the scenes this constant influence peddling is happening between mining company lobbyists and bureaucrats and politicians.
Guy Pearce is one of the few Australians that really has provided important detail in opening the door in how influence is peddled in this country, where people who once were advisors to politicians are then cross the line and are then working at the top level in companies. So they know how Parliament works, they know how who the networks within government, how they can influence people, and so you often end up that you have senior people in companies effectively writing the policy of government.
I've returned home to help organise my friends, family and their friends and family to come up into rural Australia to see the devastation of what is happening and to themselves take action to stop it, to stop a devastation and destruction that our government is failing to do themselves.
I hosted this gathering of the Maules Creek protesters because I completely agree with the convoy against corruption. Everything you can see in all the distance is land owned by Malaban Coal and Yulin Coal that borders on the mountain there. They approached us about 4 years ago and they said we're in the area where they had to either buy us out or pay compensation. They've done none, they've done neither. And over the years, they've expanded, developed, they've got traffic everywhere, noise. They've driven the whole community out of the place. And now I applaud the convoy because they're up there doing what we might have done if we were better organised then, but they sort of crept up on us. I've been here for 30 years and now there is no community left. Just like if you read Sharon Munro's book, you'll see they've done the same thing all over the country. And for me, these people that are doing this now are setting the groundwork for the last thing we can do because they change the rules, they change the laws, they change the government. We might as well have the Tea Party nutters in power for what they're doing to take away the rights of the little people and using their own powers to tramp roughshod over the little people on behalf of multinational corporations.
Coal has come to dominate the city more and more until we have become the largest coal port in the world. Having a fourth coal terminal will further intensify the increasingly monocultural nature of the city of Newcastle. I understand it will take 10 years at full capacity export to pay for the construction of this terminal. We cannot depend on such an unpopular commodity to cover the enormous costs of this project, let alone for it to create any economic benefit for the community. There is no economic justification to approve this development. The port is far from capacity and it has not yet reached the trigger tonnage to require T4 to be built.
The economics of the T4 coal terminal that's proposed for Newcastle at the moment are really interesting. The original assessments, which were given to planning and to the government, are clearly unrealistic. They're claiming net benefits of $60 billion. That's enough for two NBNs. Generated from a glorified jetty down in Newcastle? Not possible. Internal documents that have recently been obtained under Freedom of Information show that the proponents of the project themselves don't think that there's going to be a great demand for more coal out of Newcastle.
We will be a city that's dominated by coal exporting facilities that are not operating. It'll be a ghost city. That port will be a ghost port and we will become like Detroit or Flint in Michigan. Those cities are bankrupt.
What we see every day is our politicians using the same lines as the mining company, that we provide thousands of jobs or millions, billions of dollars in royalties to state coffers. So what we see is the mining industry constantly trying to claim that it provides more of a contribution than it really does. And politicians are constantly trying to, I think, mislead the community about the benefits of the mining industry and significantly downplay the costs to both our society, our economy, and particularly the environment.
In terms of how much tax do mining companies pay, it's a little bit like how long is a piece of string or how short is a piece of string. You've got examples like Glencore or Xstrata who've been recently reported as paying zero tax, paying no tax, largely because they're able to transfer and relocate their profits and sales, and in the end their Australian company didn't make any money, so it didn't pay any tax.
Stop the bulldozers!
Last Sunday, we took a bus ride up to Malt Creek. We understood that it was a journey that we needed to take as a group in order to understand this issue better. We visited the coal mines. We didn't realize that the coal mines were that big. You know, we had people from Tokelau and Kiribati sharing how when they looked at the overburden, they saw the size of their island. And it was hard for them to accept that, you know, that's how it is. This is the reason why our islands are sinking. This is the reason why we can't keep our islands above water, because money is winning. And so we are here as warriors to tell the world that we are not drowning, we are fighting.
We are sitting in the area of greatest influence when faced with humanity's greatest threat of climate change. 50 years from now, nobody is going to care how much we earned, nobody is going to care what kind of car we drove or what kind of things that we have in our life. What they're going to wonder is where we were in a critical point where the coal industry was massively expanding, tearing apart communities, and we had a chance to make a difference in the world.
When I first looked, when I first started to get worried about 2009, I discovered that of the 37 really nasty pollutants in Singleton's air, and I mean like sulfuric acid, mercury, arsenic, lead, etc., all but two of the 37 were above the levels harmful to human health. And those two were just below those levels. Singleton was complaining a lot about the dust in those years. National Pollutant Index then said it carried 30,000 tonnes of fine particulates, PM10, in its air. And it seemed a lot, even though we had 13 mines. So I looked up Scone. I'm in Sconeshire, Upper Huntershire, has no coal mines or coal power. It had less than one tonne. In the Hunter, we have an air quality monitoring system. We fought hard for it, but it's not as wonderful as it sounds. People get email or SMS alerts on the days when the levels exceed the standards of what's permitted. On those days, people with heart or respiratory conditions are advised to stay indoors and switch on the aircon. Some schools, like where my grandchildren were going, keep the pupils inside on exceedance days.
The PM2.5 particles are mostly combustion products, so that comes from vehicle exhausts, from burning diesel in locomotives, comes out of bushfires, mostly from combustion processes. Coal dust is likely to be in the larger particle size, up to 10 microns, so that also has serious health impacts, more lung disease and heart disease, both acute and chronic effects, and slanted more towards a burden of lung disease than heart disease, which is caused more by the fine particles.
About 37% of the carbon dioxide that is emitted into the air from man-made activity is derived from coal. So you can say that 37% of the disease burden caused by climate change, and to be caused by climate change if we keep up the same rate of producing coal, the ratio stays the same, will be caused by the burning of coal.
It's often discussed that we can afford to burn about 20% of the proven fossil fuel reserves in the world. But that's based on the idea that you have a chance of about 66% of staying below the magic 2 degrees C temperature limit, which the nations around the world have agreed upon. Now, there are a couple of things wrong with that. One, 2 degrees C is already too high, and that's clear from the evidence around the world in places like the Arctic, where the sea ice is melting very rapidly, in the Antarctic, where you're seeing glaciers breaking up far faster than we expected, with the increase in ocean acidification, which is affecting the food chain. And the effect of all of these sort of things has a positive feedback effect, where one small change can then produce a much bigger change over time. For example, if you look at the Arctic sea ice, that melts, the white ice disappears, and you're left with grey-green sea, which then absorbs more solar radiation. And so the warming speeds up, and that in turn leads to the melt of the permafrost. You get large methane and CO2 emissions from the permafrost, which contributes to even further warming.
A catastrophe has been put on the table from the United Nations, from NASA down, credible organisations, and instead we're burying our heads in the sand and making laws to give more protection to the people who are destroying the planet.
We can't stand by and pretend to be moral people and just be in our synagogues and churches and mosques and just let that all happen. Before, we were just leaving it to small social justice groups. Now this is involving whole synods that are having to debate the issues.
And it is entirely unacceptable that any private company should be pocketing the profits while the rest of us are left to deal with their mess.
So we're hoping to deliver the message from all of you and from the Pacific Warriors.
So we're very pleased to be with Greenpeace on this at the Whitehaven Coal AGM and be able to stand side by side with people of goodwill who have very strong ethics and align ourselves with those people to oppose something which is basically immoral.
Being here today is critical not only to tell that story, but to represent the hundreds and even thousands of people who've been camped out at Moles Creek for more than 2 years to protest this mine. 240-odd people have been arrested, most of them first time. They're not activists who have done this their whole lives. They feel strongly now that they must take action. There are people like Bill Ryan, who's out front, 92 years old, who's been arrested 6 times at Moles Creek. He feels this is the line in the sand, and we agree. That's why we're here now, and we'll have people inside the AGM to ask the tough questions about why we're still investing in coal.
When coal industry experts talk about the international outlook for coal, they invariably talk about China being a huge growth market, and they talk about India coming up behind, and that even if China slows or actually peaks its coal consumption, doesn't matter, India's going to take all the slack. Now, a minor point there, I don't believe India can actually afford the price of imported coal. The cost of imported coal is double the cost of domestic coal, And so by definition, you need double the power price. And India has a massive inflation problem. They have massively high interest rates as a result. The last thing the new Prime Minister of India wants to do is import a whole lot more inflation. I have very high expectations that Prime Minister Modi will actually look at the energy security issues of India, and he'll realise, or already realises, that the best form of energy security is energy diversity. So if you're in that situation, you've got a current account deficit, you've already got massive inflation and so on, you need jobs, you're probably going to promote labour-intensive domestic industries that give you diversity of energy supply. Now that is solar, that is distributed solar on rooftops, it is wind, and it's hydro.
So you may ask, why is 100% renewables so reliable? How can it compete in reliability with fossil fuels? Well, the answer we found from our computer simulations and modelling is that renewable energy actually consists of two types of power station. There are variable renewable sources like the wind. Wind actually plays the major role, and it does this because it's the cheapest of the new renewable energy technology. Solar energy contributes about 40 to 45%. The better known technology is solar photovoltaics, or PV, without batteries, and they do fluctuate a lot. But we can balance those fluctuations with concentrated solar thermal power with thermal storage. This technology usually has large power stations with thousands of mirrors focusing the sunlight, creating lots of heat. Some of that heat can be converted directly into electricity, and some of it can be stored quite cheaply during the night time if necessary, so that these stations can actually generate during the night as well as during the daytime. So we have the two types of solar playing complementary roles, and also gas turbines, which are like jet engines, running on renewable gases and liquids. And those flexible, so-called dispatchable sources basically balance the fluctuations in the more variable sources like wind and solar PV. The secret really of getting 100% renewable electricity is to have a mix of flexible sources and variable sources.
Politicians are caught between their innate conservatism. They want to do what worked in the past, even though coal, of course, won't work in the future. And also, there is a huge amount of political power wrapped up in the extractive industries, both through the workforce, even though it's diminishing, but more importantly, through the corporate connections of the big extractive industries, particularly coal. It's an albatross around the neck of New South Wales that we have politicians who simply can't see a different kind of future.
We know the science. We know that global warming is a disaster, and we can mitigate this somewhat if we stop putting carbon dioxide in the atmosphere. Anybody who knowingly burns coal or promotes the mining of coal is complicit in making life very difficult, if that not killing billions of people, and including in Australia, it'll make life difficult for our grandchildren, our children.
It's not a question of what is politically realistic in the way that our politicians tend to talk. You know, we can only do this because it's too hard otherwise. You really now just have to do what is really required. I mean, Winston Churchill talked about this many, many years ago. He said, look, it's no good doing your best. Sometimes you actually have to do what's necessary.
It's going to take a mighty effort to dislodge an industry as powerful as coal.
Let's pretend it isn't happening. Let's pretend it isn't true. Let's pretend that we can go on just the way we used to do. Let's pretend that cutting carbon 5%, 10% or maybe 5% will be enough to shape a future that our children can survive. Let's pretend that giving handouts to those polluters who are worst will in some strange way save our future from forever being cursed. Let's pretend that it isn't happening. Let's pretend it isn't true. Let's pretend that we can go on just the way we used to do. Let's pretend that there's a method of burning coal that's clean and green. Let's pretend that nuclear power's cleaner than it's ever been. Let's pretend that turning lights out and giving plastic bags away by itself is all that's needed to usher in a brand new day. Let's pretend that we can go on just the way we used to.